Without further ado, I'm going to introduce Michael himself.
Thank you.
All right. I'm going to let a lot of pictures do the talking for me. Thank you all for coming tonight. All right, I'm going to shift this to the next one. This title kept coming up while talking to people after I arrived, but there's definitely a very strong vibe amongst Antioch family members throughout the years, and in a lot of ways it feels like we drank the Yellow Springs Kool-Aid more than the water in the springs. I want to keep on task and put some bullet points out there so that you can all help me, because once I start talking about work, I can ramble. I get really excited because I'm usually working on 5 different series at one time. And so I point in motion a lot, and you need to help contain me a little bit. Number one, Antioch was the right choice for me. It came into my life at a time where I wasn't sure if I wanted to go to school. I didn't know exactly what I wanted to do, but I knew that I needed a lot more in my life than art school. I wanted to know more about the world, and I wanted to meet new people with different experiences from all over the world. And I met my core family at Antioch. And I'll talk about this more later on, but in the last few years, I've lost both of my parents, and it's a lot of my family that I met just in the 4 years that I was here that live a couple blocks away from me in Brooklyn. I've been almost closer in a lot of ways than a lot of my family was growing up. I want to mention this too, because the programming here is amazing, and I'm sandwiched right in between 2 very intense shows. But for me, art is political no matter what, because it's always going to be an extension of your heart and the person that it's coming from. And for me, a lot of the work that I make is trying to process darker information and turning it into something more beautiful so that I can share a little bit of joy with others at times when it's most needed, but also give myself a process based way of working in which I can heal just from making the work. Throwing that out there. And also giving back as much as you take. I think throughout the years I've met so many products of art schools and really see this whole different learning method and curriculum in which students are leaving with greater senses of ego and branding and really only thinking about their work. But for me, thinking about people and my experiences in the world are my muses first and foremost, and then the art follows, and then that same world and those people are my audience. Oh, and then I should talk about my work and how I make it, because it varies considerably. All right, I was born. My mom had a beehive for most of her life, actually. So I was raised in a small town called Niles, Michigan. If I recall, it was a good 4.5-hour drive back and forth to campus. And my father was a Palestinian war refugee, born in 34, and had a very long and difficult journey to make it to Niles, Michigan, of all places. And my mother grew up in Flint, Michigan. So in a lot of ways, I like to consider myself a quintessential American. She grew up the child of very conservative GM workers, and was told that if she wanted to go to secondary school, she could be a secretary or a teacher. So from a very early age, I realized that there were, and also living in a very conservative small town, that there was a lot that I needed to learn and escape from and grow from, and I almost could just skip ahead to Antioch right now, but. this is one of my first art projects. I didn't bring it with me. It didn't fare too well over the years. On to the new phase of electronic artwork, my first Light Bright. And I'm not wearing pants in the photo. And then here is where we start getting a little more figurative, which will lead to the top floor portrait gallery. Now, this one, I'm pretty sure is one of maybe only three self-portraits I've ever made ever. I'm not my own muse most of the time, and this is the only one I know of where I'm eating a monster, possibly dinosaur. Then in my wacky high school years, I started playing around, which I didn't even really make the connection because there's a lot of cut paper work in the show, but I was doing a lot of cut paper collages and drawing from the collages, but I was always throwing away the collage pieces, so I never even thought of that as being part of the project. I was 16, I didn't know what I was doing. And then I decided it was time to get ready for college, and I worked at a Wendy's. Some of the hardest work I've ever done. I was a crew leader. I got to make all the side salads. And when I was ready to do my first weekend visit as a prospective at Antioch, I remember that I wore a baseball hat all the time. I was a goofy skater kid. And I lost my regular hat, so I wore my actual Wendy's hat because I just always had to have a hat on. And I remember these New York City kids telling me, "Whoa, that's super cool." And I was too afraid to tell them that I worked there, and that was like my work. It was like ironic, cool that I was wearing a Wendy's hat. I kept making more work throughout high school and still like really connected with figurative work because people are what I knew, and it made sense to me. Like I could connect with seeing little Bootsy Collins a little roughed up. In any case, so I found out about Antioch through my older sister who was attending Kalamazoo College and opened up the whole world of the GLCA schools to me. And aside from Pratt Institute, which I'll come back to later, I only applied to GLCA schools and wasn't sure about Antioch at first based on the fine art program, but it wasn't until I visited and came and met the people, and some of the people I met on my prospective weekend I'm still friends with, that I was sold and I had no other option. So this is my first dorm room in Birch. And my first roommate, Mike O'Shea, who lives two blocks away from me in Brooklyn, we coexisted and were referred to as Mike and Mike for several years. I'll come back to that. Now, during this first year in school, I started meeting other artists and was like, "Whoa, you're still at a dark room? What kind of magical place are you from?" Like, I was learning all these things about new techniques and printmaking. I'd never tried printmaking before. And after meeting a few people and mentioning that I was from Niles, Michigan, they were like, "Oh, like French paper." They knew about it because it's some of the most amazing paper ever. I'll get to this later, but all those pieces are made from their paper. So this stuck in my head for years before I would go back to my hometown. During my time at Antioch, I was a Bonner Scholar, so as part of the scholarship program, I had to spend 20 hours a week working in community service, and most of my 4 years I volunteered at WISO, working on fund drives, which got my fundraising bug. Some of my favorite co-op experiences, I worked at Mills Lawn and I developed an after-school art program for elementary school students. I worked at the Krasol Art Center, which will come back to me later too. This is in St. Joseph, Michigan, about 40-minute drive north of where I grew up. And then I spent time working at the Dayton Visual Arts Center. Oh, you know what? Back up to Krasol. This was my very first co-op. And 3 days a week, they had funding for an intern. And so the opposite days of the week, Tuesdays and Thursdays, my second job during high school was working for a landscaping company. So I alternated between wearing a suit and tie one day and then getting dirty in yards on the opposite days, which the two different ways of working, the two different ways of being treated from one job to the next from the people around me had a weird impact on me that I revisited later in my senior show here in the Herndon. I juxtaposed my experiences during my first co-op and made figurative portraits of some of these family members that I met while a student here. At the time, I was fixated on photorealism, because I think like a lot of younger art students, just like, well, that's the ultimate. If I can make something look exactly like something that already exists, well, that's amazing. It's really not amazing at all, because the photograph is fun, but that's just me. Oh, so the gnomes that I made were actually somewhat based on ones that I discovered while working on the landscaping job, but then I made them a little bit more menacing and positioned them just right that you didn't want to get close enough to the painting to tell that it really wasn't that photorealistic. Seemed genius at the time. But a lot of fun, and in fact, this was the other thing too. Like, so this is wrapping up my 4 years here, right when I'm like really getting into my stride and knowing what I'm doing in college. It's like, oh no, I'm losing all my access to facilities, which is crazy, and I have not touched ceramics since this time. The gnomes, hotcakes, all of them sold that day, and when somebody asked me how much they were, I didn't have an answer because I'd never even thought about selling work. And I think I sold them for $40, maybe. It was great, because $40 is amazing then. I cut out this little portion where I then left and became a substitute teacher at my old high school in Michigan for 6 months, but it's so dark that it does not need to be discussed right now. That's when I moved. I moved to Brooklyn without an apartment or a job and just tried to figure it out. The next 12 years, I had student loan debt, and it was serious enough that the romantic thought of being a starving artist is not in my reality. So, and I attribute this to going to Antioch, but I really felt that if I couldn't be actively making 24 hours a day, that I at least need to be working for institutions and helping them so that programming could happen or that students could earn scholarships to go to school. And for almost 6 years, I worked at the Brooklyn Academy of Music, performing arts venue, really incredible. Opened my eyes to a lot of performance and musical and dance companies that I hadn't been familiar with, and met really inspiring people that I would never think that I would cross paths with, but it just happens when you're in cities like that. And from there I went to Pratt Institute and worked on raising student scholarship funds for 6 years. In this like crazy 12-year period, I got to work with Laurie Anderson and Lou Reed before he passed away. I did a fundraising event honoring Patti Smith, Marc Jacobs. I did the first lecture with Martha Stewart right out of prison. I got to work with Elizabeth Kelly before he passed away, which was very inspiring. And then I worked with some total... I know that's subjective, but... gave me a microphone. At this point, I've saved up, I've paid off all my student loans, and I put together a surplus of funds that could last me for 6 months. The first project I did is I revisited portraiture again with the help of my old Antioch roommate, Mike O'Shea, and I went back and asked a lot of the key figures that had helped out with my fundraising initiatives over the years if they would pose for portraits. And then I pitched an exhibition of the portraits, sales proceeds to go back to Pratt Student Scholarships and then the Fine Arts Program at Brooklyn Academy of Music. Then this one is the hilarious one that I keep getting a lot of questions about. This is the president of Pratt Institute and his wife and their show dog, Nelly. And they withheld payment for their portrait, which also withheld payment for the student scholarship funds at the school that he was the president of. So years later, it fell out of the storage space. And I was just like, oh, like I really love the painting and like real heart went into making it, but it felt tainted by some sort of bad energy. So I wanted to reclaim it and make it my own. And I poured fuchsia automotive enamel over their heads. And it was like, this is gonna be great. Now I've got like this happy, funny painting that I can hold on to. And automotive enamel is very opaque and leaves like a hard candy-like shell. And 3 days later, their faces just started appearing through it again. And it's like, touche. They got me again. So this is actually the first and maybe only time I'll ever show it. But I love the painting, and I made it my own. You can't take it from me.
Can you go back one?
Sure. I'm publicly shaming them, it's okay. So as this show is getting ready to go on, I've been making, like, painting like crazy and making so much work, but really haven't sold anything in the 6 months is starting to dwindle. And then out of nowhere, my friend Jonathan Robert, who was a student here 2 years ahead of me, who's now working for Showtime, contacts me. I'm just like, are you still painting? Because we're working on this series for Oliver Stone, and we pitched the ad campaign for it, and was wondering if we could have something that's more tactile and handmade, and can you do this? I went for it, and they liked it, and it saved me, it bought me another year and a half of working.
History is exciting, and I want to make it as exciting as it can be. We take a history subject and we make it not only dramatic, but we are compassionate. I always felt there's a disconnect about what's officially reported and what actually happened. We can't accept the stuff that's handed down. This is the key to the whole series, is to find out how we got to where we are and who we are. It's a great, great story.
Yes. You know, there's always the debate of a fine artist working in commercial field and like selling out and blah, 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 blah. But I had so much creative energy that had been at bay for so long that I was so excited to be able to work on a challenging creative project. And one that I was interested in, but also doing something that I didn't know that I could pull off. And that kind of like shaped a lot of the direction of the art that I was making afterwards. With challenge and trying to achieve the unknown, sort of. And that commercial won a National Design Award. So they kept hiring me back.
You need to see the script?
No, I'm good.
And action.
Live.
Son of a bitch.
Cut.
Woohoo! Ah! Joey!
You got me. Looks like we did.
You're the prettiest girl in the room.
Matt is a little...
My bad.
Well, that's me, the gift that keeps on giving.
So if you've ever dreamed of having Joey from Friends implanted in your brain when you're trying to sleep, I had to draw his face like 9,000 times. And then they give me something like this, which was even creepier and more challenging than the next one.
I've always been a very neat monster. But lately,
The truth has begun to spill. And too many people have seen the full picture. I'm losing control. And the only thing I know for sure is that it isn't going to be pretty.
The final season of the show Dexter, which I'd never seen before, but they required that I watch all 7 seasons in like a 6-week period, which is not healthy or okay for anybody to watch. And like, but it was like the challenge with this is they're just like, well, we want something that when it's like completely revealed, looks like he's made out of blood splatters. And it was like, how do you reverse engineer that kind of process, and I had to figure out how to mix the craziest combination of paint and inks and gel mediums so that I could paint it with an eyedropper from 4 feet high, have it splatter on the canvas, but then when it dries still look wet, and it was like a laboratory, and I dried the bus home. My studio's in Queens at the time. And forget that I've been working on it all day, and I look like I have blood all over me, and people were just like, so like these ad jobs are coming in, and it's great, and it's like challenging and fun, and it's helping me pay my bills, and so I continue working and fundraising and volunteering. I met Amy Goodman here. Right at the very beginning of Democracy Now, for a talk that she gave in the Herndon Gallery. And years later, after I've been working in fundraising for years, I have, like, aside from being able to make bloody paintings, like, I have crazy database skills, too. So I volunteer whenever they need me during fund drives, and I process all the pledge gifts that come in, and then process premiums and send out the mugs for them, and it's amazing that like somehow I reconnected after being inspired and meeting her here in the space years and years ago, that I'm like getting to meet with her again. And then her head of development used to be my intern at Brooklyn Academy of Music before that, and it's just crazy worlds colliding. This next scene is really important timing with how I started shifting from doing these figurative pieces to not anymore. Kathy, that's in the portrait up top, told me that she wanted to use that piece as part of a lecture at the Met. And she's like, it's not hanging on the wall, but I'll take like a projected piece there. It was really exciting. And I was getting ready to go. Here it is next to the inspiration for it, which is her favorite Jacques-Louis David painting. I got a call the night before that my mom had passed away. And she already had tickets to come, some fly out to New York to see that portrait show that I've been working on. And she hadn't really come out to visit me the whole time I was there, so it was really a big deal. And she also didn't think that I was nuts to quit my full-time job to paint. So she was a big champion, and to have all that happen, it was really brutal at the time, and I still had 2 more paintings to finish before that show within like a 3-week period, and trying to do that while driving back and forth from Brooklyn to Michigan was, I still don't remember some of it, and it, you know, it took probably a good year to even process the concept of mourning. So for a couple of months, I was driving back and forth every other week to Niles, Michigan, my hometown. And during this time, I reconnected with a couple of high school friends that I hadn't seen 15 years that were still working at the paper mill in town, the French paper mill that I was talking about earlier. And as a means for distraction, I just kind of started obsessing over the mill and their paper, and was like trying to figure out what I could do with it while I was there to have a project to work on. It didn't take well to paint, which was my primary medium. I just started cutting it. and recreating the entire paper mill out of their paper. And some, through the Shoshana organization in Manhattan, there were originally 21 pieces, all the same size, and together it's just, it was so exciting to see all of it together. And then this is crazy because then all of a sudden I get a blind email from a curator at the Krassel Arts Center where I interned for a co-op saying that they had read press coverage of the show in New York. They really love the idea and they love that since it was somewhat local to where they were located, that maybe if I would maybe consider it. And I was like, I would love to go back. And they had no idea because their whole staff had already changed guards at that point. It was really incredible. Like they of all art centers in the country that picked up on it. I've worked there and I learned a lot about curating just in that time spent. The video piece that's upstairs that you should check out, their headphones connected to it, but they commissioned an animated version of all of these works, and it's set to a soundtrack that I made from field recordings in the real factory. And at that show, we projected it onto a giant roll of French's white paper. And so at this point, I'm cutting paper, and I start making pieces like that one over there. And selecting paper the same way that I was selecting paint to work with on a palette. And selecting different blades, kind of the way that I was with brushes. But the paper was limiting. I couldn't mix colors the way that I was with paint and working in portraiture, which wound up being really freeing to me because I realized that after a really long time of figurative portrait work, that just because I had been doing it since I was really young and I always was told like, you're great at it, doesn't mean that that's what I wanted to be doing. And I really need to follow my intuition, my instincts, and make what feels right. And I've been circling back and doing more figurative work now because it feels good and it feels right now. But after that one series and maybe the connection with my mom passing, completing 9 portraits that were 100-hour paintings back to back to back to back, there was a point where it didn't feel good, like I was creating something from passion anymore, but more like almost solving math equations. Like, I know exactly how this painting should end up being when I finish, so where's the joy and the excitement of not knowing what's to come? There's like no aha moments. And then through cut paper pieces, I started getting hired to do cut paper ads. Mark Frost, the co-creator of Twin Peaks, published 2 bookend books to come out, one before this recent season that came out, and then one afterwards. And with a strong connection between written book and paper and making the work out of paper, but also not trying to bite a David Lynchian style, I got to recreate this whole world of Twin Peaks like out of paper, which was like a dream job for me. There's just 3 quick ones. Okay, so all this paper cutting happens, and then I am with most other things, I'm just like, I don't really want to do that anymore. I want to paint again. This is another effect of my mother passing away, but one thing that happened while packing up her house is I discovered all of her LPs, which I didn't even know that she had because we never listened to them growing up. Like, I learned so much about her through them. Things that I didn't even know that she liked, that I love, things that she likes that I definitely don't like, and it totally makes sense personality-wise. Her organizational patterns were different than mine, which kind of resonated with other differences that we had. And like, I realized that what seemed like these arbitrary bands of color and lines leaning on the shelves were containing more information that I found pertinent and painted a broader portrait of someone to me than a headshot did. And so I kind of got obsessed with capturing people's record collections. And by painting the lines that I was seeing of the records leaning on shelves, I was listening only to the music that was contained within those specific records from the photos I was taking, and letting the music guide my brushwork and my color selection, which is a crazy way for me to work, considering I'd never worked remotely like that before. But at the time, I think that I really needed bright, beautiful, healing colors around me. Music has always been like a huge part of my life, whether playing it or listening to it. And it gave me this process to just immerse myself into that originally started as a means to capture someone's spirit or energy just based on what they like and enjoy and as part of their collections. But then ultimately, almost like making these kinetic forms that radiate the energy that you get from listening to music. And so many things start happening with it. And the first time I exhibited one of these lenticular pieces, and if you look at it, it's two separate paintings that I've cut and spliced together. So as you're walking, they start splintering and merging together. My initial like fascination with that was like Cracker Jack lenticular toys and photographs that I loved. And I wanted to capture that energy and motion in the painting. But what it really was exciting for me was all the range of motion in between, not the back and forth, but like the subtle shifts and changes, and how I could achieve hundreds of paintings within one that could always feel a little bit different or be experienced in different ways. And I made 8 to 10 of these paintings in that series, and then I got to a point where the mystery of how to make them is really, really difficult to structure and compose. Very, very labor intensive, and it's, I started working on like an 11th one, and I just felt like the mystery of how to make it was gone, and I felt like I was phoning it in and it didn't have that connection anymore. So I stopped, and then what I started doing was seeing if I could figure out how to capture that same energy and movement within a two-dimensional form. So in the back wall over here, I started calling this delenticulating, where I was using the three-dimensional painting as a model to paint a flattened version of looking at it head-on, which was insanely challenging. I wanted to see, like, if this had existed in a three-dimensional form, I must translate flattened, because it's like painting a still life. I'm painting what I'm seeing. So, and when I've exhibited them side by side, it's really hard to tell that one of them's not three-dimensional anymore, or they're not both flat. And then to go even crazier, because I like switching mediums, to the left of the center one, I recreated the flat one out of cut paper. Which is very, very challenging in a whole different way. And then midway through working on that, I started from the center and built my way out on a backing piece of black paper. I liked how it looked skewed on the tabletop where I was cutting it, so I stopped and did a still life of the cut paper one. And then to the right of the center one in the back wall, I did a 9-color separation screen print of the cut paper version. And then like, done. I don't want to do any of that ever again. But I was trying to figure it out and see if I could do it was the exciting part to me. And then from working on this series, I got to make a beer for my neighborhood. So that's that. Oh God, now I seem like I'm crazy. That painting that I made that was used for the beer cans came from printing out the flattened version of the painting, chopping it up with scissors, and reconfiguring it into another pattern, and then repainting that. And then it became a beer. And then, like, my whole process changed. So I started doing architectural pieces. I lived above this crazy dive bar that opened at 10 a.m., closed at 4 a.m. I barely slept. I would wake up to Who Let the Dogs Out blasting through my floor. Like, this is so many years after that song came out. Like, I don't... Every night. And as a means to try to process this, like, horrible situation, I tried to make this bright, beautiful project out of it. So I was taking photographs out my back window of the fire escapes and different ways that I could get out of the building. And then I did line drawings from that, and then from the line drawings I made cut paper models. And then I would just mix up the cut paper models to try to replicate how scattered and crazy I felt. And then I did paintings from those. And this is the painting, stage 4. And then that became a whole new process for me, where I just kept switching from medium to medium to medium and, like, playing with every tool that I really enjoy working with, without the expectation of a final piece that's great. Like, a lot of the paintings were terrible, and that's okay, I painted over them. Sometimes it was the cut paper piece that I really liked, and I held on to that little composition. But also the cut paper process, every time I'm working, is sort of the Zen moment. Like, I have to be very calm and patient and put myself in a good place, or I'll have to go back to that picture where I cut my finger. Making that be a part of this process of trying to deal with a bad situation, like, really helped me work through that. And then the end result, you can't tell that Who Let the Dogs Out was driving me insane. And then for my cut paper process, I started making cut panel painted collages. This piece is upstairs. And then also working from weird accidents that happened in the studio. I came in one morning and this cut paper model of an interior that I made had been blown apart in a really, really creepy, mysterious way. So I just took note of it and painted it the way that I found it in the studio. And it's wild, because I would have never painted that as a composition if I hadn't found some sort of ghost evidence in my studio. And this was from an apartment that I lived in, and this waste basket just kept falling over. Every morning I'd get up, it was just knocked over, and there was no logical reason for it. Oh, and then this, like, I was done making lenticular work, but I learned so much about woodworking that I love playing with these new forms. And I recreated an Afghan that my grandmother sent to me while I was here at Antioch. It's one of the most psychedelic things I've ever seen. And it was mainly because she was using different remnants of skeins from different decades. So avocados and oranges were mixing with rainbow gradients and brown, hot pink, in this fearless way where it's like, you get it, Grandma, you get it, Rena. And she was the meanest Yahtzee player I've ever felt with. She'd, like, shame you and make you cry and go home. And then I'm going to wrap this up with the final one, but the piece back there in the video next to it is probably the most unlike anything else in here. And sort of like finding that piece blown apart in my studio and just rolling with a weird discovery. I started looking through some of the paint peel from my palette from working on the other paintings and noticing little, like, goblin-y forms and weird little creatures that I would never paint on my own, but picking them out, I like to think that subconsciously I was getting something else out while I'm mixing paint. And I saved all of them and I scanned them and made a collage out of them and then repainted all the mixed paint gobs, which is really, really difficult to recreate something that you nonchalantly mixed from scratch. So another, like, giant challenge in the studio. And then I animated it. I'm donating 30% of the sales from the show towards future art programming here, so that this space is amazing. It's still blowing my mind to have all this work in here, and I want to see more shows in here. So tell all of your art buying friends to keep the programming going and keep my gas bill. Okay, I gotta go, bye.
Thank you.